So thank you all so much for coming. I'm Eli, I'm one of the many volunteers who put this together tonight. And first, I just want to start by thanking everyone who was involved in making this happen, many of whom are not able to be here tonight. I particularly want to call out Sally Bagshaw. Thank you, Sally. It's actually because of Sally that we're having this event. She's the one who said, Mark and Greg are in town. We should just have some things, you know, make something happen. And so thanks to them, we're all able to be here tonight. And Sally's going to be leading the closing section of tonight's event. It is my sincere honor and privilege to be welcoming Mark and Greg to Seattle. They are, as you all know, the principals behind Portland's Neighborhood Greenway program. The program is transforming the city of Portland as we know it. By the year 2015, 80% of Portlanders are either going to live on a family-friendly biking or walking street. They're going to be within a half mile of one. And with apologies to Dan Savage, it actually gets even better than that, because all these streets connect into a coherent network, which means that if you know, you're down there hitting the food carts, or maybe you're trying to take your kids to school or around the neighborhood, you actually have a way to get around the city safely by bike and by foot, comfortably and pleasantly. When I ride them, it always stuns me that you see people of all ages, you see an equal gender mix. It's just pure delight. And I think that's part of the power of Greenways, is addressing that equity question we have in bicycling today. I want to also share my most recent Greenway story. I have to admit, I go down to Portland every few months just to ride on the Greenways. So I was just there staying at the Hawthorne Hostel with two of my friends, one of whom is a physician, and he hasn't biked since he was a kid. He would never bike in Seattle streets. He is afraid. He's very safety conscious. My other friend, Reed, is someone who I got him to sign up for the Cascade bike classes. He did Beyond Street work. And after 6 months, he just threw in the towel because he could not feel safe on our streets. He traded his bike for a gym membership, and now he just drives around again. And both of them, within an hour on the Greenways, they were just filled with smiles. They were getting around. They didn't even need my help. I was rendered obsolete by the infrastructure. And so these are people who never would have ridden a bicycle in Seattle, who had the opportunity and loved it. And the question, I think, is, can we do it here? And I just want to step back and be very clear. The purpose of tonight's event is not to cause mass Portland envy. Please do not call your realtors yet. Instead, we wanted to have a community conversation about Seattle. And this conversation really is about one big question. And that question is, who should our streets and our bicycle infrastructure be designed for? There are two reasons why I think it's really important that everyone in this room is in this conversation, and is in this conversation over the coming months. The first one is that we are getting our five-year update to the Bike Master Plan in 2012. We have a chance to ask our leaders for a plan that makes bicycling safe for everyone. Not 3%, not five, maybe 5% if we're lucky, for everyone. Right? How many people do you know, like my friends, who would love to ride, but who are prevented because we don't have the infrastructure that lets them do what they already want to do? It's not about getting people out of their cars, it's about letting people who want to ride a bike just ride their damn bikes. Secondly, Proposition 1. And who's already familiar with Prop 1? Raise your hand. Okay, I think it's pretty much everyone. And I just, you know, just at risk of preaching to the choir, I think it is important because of the fact that this is our most promising funding source for Greenways. If it's passed, our odds of actually getting these at scale in Seattle is going to be a lot bigger. So I just wanted to say, oh, sorry, go ahead.
And there are people here like me you can talk to afterwards if you're interested in volunteering for that campaign. You need a lot of help.
And please raise your hand if you're on the campaign. There's Chris Roll, there's Bryce. So they would love to talk to you about getting involved. They're looking for volunteers, and the training, I have to say, looks really exciting. So the Facebook invite for this event had a short film about Neighborhood Greenways that you're probably going to see again tonight. But I just want to ask, who's already seen it? Raise your hand. So keep your hand up if you're inspired by it. And who already wants one in your neighborhood? So that's like pretty much all of us. So to me, this is really inspiring stuff. And I hope you're going to get even more inspired with Greg and Mark here in person rather than just on YouTube. My hope for tonight, though, is this will be more than an educational and inspiring event. My hope is that for some of you, this will be the night you decide you want to roll down or roll up your sleeves, get involved in making this happen in your neighborhood. Because we're not just waiting for all of our other city leaders besides Sally Bagshaw to get the value of greenways. We actually have groups already working in our neighborhoods making it happen to show our city leaders that we want this now, not eventually 20 years from now, but now. And if you live in Beacon Hill, Wallingford, U District, Ballard, there are already groups working in your neighborhood. They'd love to have volunteers, people interested in getting involved. Everyone there is wearing a name tag just like mine. There'll be more of them popping in later in the evening. Raise your hand if you're already involved in a neighborhood group. It's funny. Wow. So I just want to show you like what's going on. We're not just talking about greenways. We're actually getting it done. I think Kathy Tuttle is the first, I don't know if you're the grandma of greenways. So Kathy actually went out, built community support and consensus across Wallingford, and got $110,000 of grant funding for our first greenway. It's going to be built within 90 days. We didn't wait for the city to happen. She just went, made it happen, and she's now working with them on making it go successfully. To our south in Beacon Hill, we have the awesome Beacon Bikes group, which actually went out, and I think for the first time in Seattle, got a family bicycle and pedestrian plan. And what that means is the plan is about actually looking at how do people in Beacon Hill want to get around? Where do their families need to go? Where are the schools? The idea of destination-based planning of how do people here get to where they actually need to go to? And the idea of transportation being about the community, not about just accommodating people driving through the neighborhood on their way to somewhere else. And their first improvements in the community are going in this fall, and there's a whole bunch more on the way. So if you want the next chapter of Neighborhood Greenways not to be something you watch on Portlandia or hear about on YouTube, this is just a great opportunity to get involved. We'd love to have you connect with a group. We'd love to help you get a group started in your own neighborhood if you're not in one of those four. And just personally, I'm standing up here. I met Kathy for the first time in April. I think I formally met Sally in May. I met you in May. And we started the University District Group in July. So you know, things are moving very quickly. We'd love to have more folks involved. Oh, come on in. And with that, I'm going to hand you over to Mark and Greg. Let's give them a big welcome.
Thanks to everybody for coming. It's really exciting for us to be in Seattle and have so much energy for looking at neighborhood greenways and what it can do for the city. My name is Greg Raisman. I'm a traffic safety specialist with the Portland Bureau of Transportation. So I work on a variety of safety programs and kind of the lead for the city on bicycle safety and school safety, and done a lot of work with sort of crash data and kind of started the bike corral thing when we started converting some bike park, car parking to bike parking and stuff like that. And so, you know, my presentations always start with some general messaging about traffic safety because it's my mission in life. And so I always like to start with my most important message.
Back
So I'm going to start by just talking about our general approach to traffic safety, because Neighborhood Greenways is a major element that brings a lot of our traffic safety elements together. In Portland, we really try to have a balanced and comprehensive approach to traffic safety that looks at what we call six E's. In our group, we do a lot of work on engineering, education, enforcement. We have a lot of work on evaluation, encouragement, and equity. And all of these are really important factors in thinking about how to affect positive change for traffic safety and livability in a community, a whole variety of ways. We'll talk a little bit about each of those tonight. One thing that we have in Portland that is a little different than in some other communities that's been a really important tool for us is that we have what's called a traffic safety account. And so in 2003, we lobbied the state to increase traffic fines. And then went to city council and said, okay, we're gonna have some more traffic fine revenue coming into the city. Let's take that margin that's coming in and dedicate it to traffic safety services. So there's a traffic safety account that's a lockbox that is programmed against safe routes to school, reducing driver error, and bicycle and pedestrian safety, and then programmed against three E's: engineering, education, and enforcement. And this is a picture of our Traffic Safety Coordination Council that includes, it's co-chaired by police and transportation, it includes judges, neighborhoods, trauma nurses, businesses, everyone at the table, every quarter in City Hall, sitting down and talking about traffic safety, and as a group empowered with some secure funding. And that really helps us when we're going to like city council or community meetings or all these to have a really good group that knows each other, is working together, has some clout, and is able to bring some community voice to the table to advocate for some of our safety improvements and strategies. One of the things that's really important for us is that we really think that if we focus on the most vulnerable, we'll make a city that's safer for everybody. And I'll show you some numbers that kind of talk about that. So the concept is, you know, if it's safe for a child to go to their friend's house to play, it's safe to drive when you have to. And, you know, in our city, a lot of our population are children and seniors. Children up until about fourth grade have some really important needs relative to traffic safety. The development of their eyes, and actually seniors have similar issues. The peripheral vision is about 30% smaller. They have trouble perceiving speed of an object in a constant form. So what that means is, like, if a dog is running at a child or a senior, they'll do a pretty good job telling how fast it's coming because its ears are flopping, its body's changing shape. But with a car, it just stays in a constant shape, and they don't do a good job of telling how fast it's coming. So it's a perception of speed problem. There's all sorts of other things that really make them sort of the most vulnerable. When you look at crash data, children and seniors actually tend to be in error more often when there's pedestrian or bicycle crashes. A lot has to do with where they are in life. And then people with disabilities, of course, really important that we have a city that's accessible to everybody. And so, you know, when you look at the census data, it's huge groups. I mean, 20% of our population is under 18. You know, about 15% are over 60, and what we understand about 40% of them don't drive. So we have huge numbers of people that live in our city that don't drive around our city, and that we need to provide really good access through our city for. And then providing many travel options is a key safety strategy, and I'll share a little bit more about that. When we think about traffic safety, this is a quote from one of the trauma nurses that we've worked with for quite a long time that I think says a lot. Traffic crashes are not accidents. They are preventable events. They represent personal, family, and community tragedies, regardless of fault. We make choices when we're moving around that influence whether or not we're going to be in a crash. If we're speeding, if we're in the influence, we're not following the rules of the road, we're increasing that likelihood, and we have a lot of control and power. It's not a given that these things are going to happen. And when we look at our experience, we're finding that we can make a difference when we do things that really affect and target traffic safety. The graph at the top is total traffic fatalities for the city of Portland for all modes from 1986 to 2010, so it's a 25-year period. And this is the same data for the U.S. So our traffic deaths are going down 6 times faster than the rest of the nation. 2008 was our lowest number of traffic deaths since the advent of the motor vehicle. 2010 was our second lowest since the advent of the motor vehicle. Our record goes to 1923. And it's these numbers are the lowest in the history of our city. And the benefits really are across the board. When we look, this graph kind of takes from 1996 to 2010, and when we look through time, we just had a 12-year period where we had 6 years with zero bicycle fatalities. And this is a period where we saw exponential growth in the number of people riding. Every other year, on average, we have zero fatalities. For pedestrians, we had our lowest number of traffic deaths in 2008 ever. It was five. Our highest number was 53. When people were just starting to drive in the early 70s, was really high. But one of the things that really starts to come out in the data that I think is a really important part of the conversation is that the biggest beneficiaries of pedestrian and bicycle safety improvements are people in cars and trucks. In 1986, we had 61 people die as an occupant of a motor vehicle, 61 in 1986. In 1996, we had 41. Last year, we had 11. So this phenomena actually happens all over the place. I just skipped a slide. Here's an example from the Netherlands. From 1980 to 2005, they saw 45% increase in bicycle use, 39% increase in car use, and a almost 240% reduction in fatals for both. And you can see this graph on the right is death per population for US versus the Netherlands. The top graph is 1975. The red bar is the US, and the blue bar is the Netherlands. They used to have more traffic deaths per capita than we did. The bottom graph, 2008. You can see that we can do things that make differences about this stuff. This is a study that came out last year, why bicycle-friendly cities are safer for all road users, that compared 24 comparably sized cities in California. And the cities that had high bike and ped use, 3 to 15 times lower traffic fatalities across the board. So a lot of times there's these us and them portions of the conversation. Reality is that as what's happening, and my view on it is that when we're in a city where everyone's driving, you sort of go on autopilot. You know, a lot of times you interview people at the end of the trip, they can't tell you what just happened, right? They're hitting the gas hard to get to the next signal. They're not stopping at a stop sign when they don't know someone's coming their way. They're just on autopilot. When you start to have a mix of traffic and people are riding bikes and walking, you know, you don't know when you're gonna stop for someone to cross the street or to share the road with the bike or negotiate with the bus, it becomes a much more dynamic experience. I mean, people in Portland definitely can tell me what happened at the end of the trip a lot of times. They sometimes speak about it through frustration. But what's happening is that they're a lot more aware, conscious. They're having to pay attention to what's going on around them. And the result is that in the last 15 years, we've got a 35% reduction in serious injuries for people in cars and trucks. You know, we also have a lot of health things. You know, we've talked a lot about, you know, I'm sure you guys, about inactivity and obesity and all these types of things that are endemic in our society and how much it costs us. One thing that I'll mention that's sort of not on this slide relative to Neighborhood Greenways I think is really important is there's a lot of information coming out about air particulates. And when we're on a busy street, what kind of air particulates we're taking in. And even, you know, like there was some research done in Portland State that looked at a cycle track even, and the amount of air particulates you're getting, just that much separation, much lower than when you're right next to the car. But when we're 250 feet away, 500 feet away, the exposure to particulates that are, you know, dealing with things like asthma and other respiratory problems are a lot cleaner. And so we also, you know, have that kind of benefit with the type of system we'll talk about tonight. So with that, I'm going to a little introduction to Portland traffic safety. I'm going to turn it over to Mark to describe kind of the general framework of what a neighborhood greenway is, and then we'll show the video after that, and then we'll talk a little bit about some of the specific projects and show you kind of some maps about what's going on in our city.
I'm Mark Lear. I manage the safety program, and I had a really great day today with Seattle staff looking at the different neighborhood greenway projects and safety projects that are being planned and built. And personally, I'm really impressed. I don't see any reason why Seattle can't you know, make the same progress that Portland's making with neighborhood greenways. So these next couple slides, am I just clicking on this to make it
the mouse? Cool.
So one of the main things that we're looking at when we're trying to develop our neighborhood greenways is develop that system. As Greg mentioned a minute ago, we really look at the bicycle or the neighborhood greenway network that we're building, this great place for people to walk and bike, to be very similar to what Portland did and a lot of other cities did, you know, in the 60s and 70s when they built these really dense transit networks where, you know, you can walk in any neighborhood, you go a few blocks and you're crossing a transit facility. And so for us, you know, we know that there's not any one specific type of facility. You know, some cases we're going to want a cycle track, some cases a bike lane, some cases a neighborhood greenway. There aren't any silver bullets. What we need is to get people from A to B, and it takes a mix of facility types. What we found is that when we're thinking about complete streets or complete networks, at least in Portland, we've been sort of leaning in the direction of sort of focusing more on complete networks in the short term. I mean, the complete street concept, don't get me wrong, is a good one, but I think where we were in Portland, when we looked back, you know, 3 or 4 years ago as we were putting our bike plan together, we started to do that, is what we realized is that the strategy of developing projects as funding became available, you know, you build a East Bank Esplanade like we have in Portland because the funding comes together to do that, or there's a big development occurring and you take advantage to do that. That's how you build your projects, and that's all you got. You know, we're all going to be dead before there's a network, right? And so I think there's a lot of frustration, like, well, what would we do if we wanted to build a network in 3 or 4 or 5 years? And that's what a lot of what you're going to see, what we tried to do with our neighborhood greenway program. The other thing that's really important about developing this network is it ends up serving as a platform for a whole bunch of different programs that are really important. And one of those is our Sunday Parkway program. Show of hands, how many people have heard of Sunday Parkways in Portland? Great, and I know there's something similar going on in Seattle now, and that's awesome. What's really cool about the Sunday Parkway routes that you see on this map here is that I think probably, 80%? About 80% of the routes that people are riding on when they ride on these Sunday Parkway routes, and we're getting, what's the number, 10?
We're gonna have over 100,000 participants this year.
This summer. So each event's getting, you know, 20,000 people. Is that 80% of those routes are on Neighborhood Greenway parts of the network that we're developing or we have just recently developed. And so what's nice about that is, you know, we want our Sunday Parkways to be, you know, ideally Sunday Parkways every day. And it's these neighborhood greenway routes that are serving as the foundation for that. The other thing, this is a vicious cycle diagram that you may have seen like this before, is that our neighborhood greenway programs are by far, I think, the most important tool that we have from an engineering perspective in battling this trend of kids not walking and biking to school. You know, after distance, if distance is too far, issues around traffic safety end up being the number one reason that parents aren't allowing their kids to walk and bike to school. And so, you know, this cycle that you can get into is that if parents don't feel safe, they drive their kids. If they don't see other kids walking and biking, they drive their kids. Well, the upshot is it's a vicious cycle, as the slide sort of indicates. You know, we have to, if people aren't confident with themselves riding on the street, as we heard Eli mentioning earlier, you know, it's very likely that they're also not comfortable, or you know, our data would show, that they're even more risk averse to having their kids ride on the system. Our neighborhood greenways, and you see this in the slide, the video for those of you who have seen it, are really sort of one of our best tools, especially when you look at it from a cost effectiveness to achieve many of our city goals. So obviously the transportation goals are pretty straightforward. The only one on there that I think sometimes people forget is for us and for freight planning, developing these parallel systems has been as strongly endorsed element of our bike plan as any other element. So when we were down in the legislature this year arguing in the Oregon legislature for the 20 mile per hour neighborhood greenway speed limit that we passed, not only do we have the support of the Oregon Trucking Association, which we don't always have, and AAA, but we had them actively writing letters of support and doing the lobbying that they normally would not do on an issue like this. So that's been, I think, one of the real nice things about neighborhood greenways. I mean, we've done polling work a couple years ago in Portland when we were doing an effort that wasn't as successful as the Bridging the Gap effort was here in Seattle. And we did a bunch of polling work about, you know, what would you fund for transportation? And the second most valued thing that Portlanders wanted to fund with additional revenue for transportation after synchronizing signals to save fuel and congestion was minimizing conflicts between bikes and cars, or bikes and pedestrians and cars, on our busiest streets. And again, you know, if you think about it, the neighborhood, you know, long term, as we get to 25% mode splits and 30% mode splits in American cities, cycle tracks and other kind of things really pencil out. But in the short term, as you'll see in a minute, neighborhood greenways are, you know, extremely cost effective. So they end up being a really important thing for how we, you know, develop the system. We've also been using our neighborhood greenways to meet our urban forestry standards. So we have a program called Gray to Green. You can find out more about it on the internet in Portland through our Bureau of Environmental Services, where they're actually subsidizing street trees on neighborhood greenway routes. So, you know, some of the, you know, you can go in any one of Portland's existing neighborhood greenways and see these beautiful trees and these nice canopies, you know, over the street. And a lot of those, you know, you can go back, you know, 60, 70 years, and they were clear-cut subdivisions. And so this ability over, you know, a generation or two to create a landscape that is really trail-like is something that we're really interested in. These neighborhood greenways are sort of linear parks. And that gets into this parks objective as well as the stormwater. We're doing a lot of managing stormwater on site, as we were talking earlier today. That's been, you know, a little bit harder than we anticipated out of the gate. We thought we could do about $20 million worth of projects that had really strong stormwater benefit and traffic safety benefit, basically semi-diverters, which we'll talk more about in a minute. And yeah, it's been a little bit harder to achieve. I think we'll end up with about $10 million of investment by our basically sewer agency to invest in stormwater features that keep water from going into our sewer system. Health and health equity, as Greg was talking about earlier, and definitely climate action, our climate action plan goals, the neighborhood greenway projects, especially because they serve this much larger population than we were able to serve with our bike lanes, ends up being really important. We can implement. This map gives you a sense of sort of the secret of the neighborhood greenway success. And it's not rocket science, but I think it gets missed a lot. So if you look at this map of Portland, the first thing you'd see is our busiest streets, the regional traffic ways, the, you know, I-5s and you know, the busiest streets through Portland. That's a pretty small percentage of the network. You can add to that the major city traffic streets and the district collectors and the neighborhood collectors, and you're still looking at a relatively small percent of the total network. 70% of the network, and I'm sure it's the same in Seattle or close to it, I would guess, is what we would call local streets. And those are the streets that we get to pick and choose from in developing a network with that half mile spacing to serve businesses, schools, neighborhoods. And you can just see the connectivity of those streets is pretty good. I mean, of course, we run into issues with grade and other things that we need to manage there, but you just start with such a you know, large number of streets to choose from. And I guess the only thing I'd add to this is this was really a lesson learned from transportation, or in the city, Portland at least, is that when we first started looking at what are the streets that we, you know, now that people might look at and say, like a Lincoln, for example, you know, really great street for riding bikes and walking on. That project, when it was done, was a neighborhood traffic calming project and basically went from 5,000 to 3,000, 2,000 cars a day after the project was done. And our old standard, under 3,000, definitely 2,000, was okay for a neighborhood greenway. You'll see in a minute we're actually looking for 1,000 cars a day. But what we learned was picking streets that start at 5,000 and moving them to 2,000 cars a day can pretty much end your career, or you kind of wish you did. If you start with streets that are 300 cars a day, then instead of doing diverters, where you're diverting traffic onto hopefully an arterial or a busier street where it should be, you're actually just maintaining the local traffic. And we've tried with limited success, I think, in sort of renaming diverters to maintainers when we're not actually diverting traffic. But people kind of get the point. If you come into a neighborhood meeting and you say, we're going to divert 3,000 cars a day off this busy street, you know, the whole neighborhood is on fire, right? Because everybody sees that traffic coming to their street. And so by starting with, like, you know, really understanding the network and really using all those neighborhood resources, you know, that this room is full of, and transportation resources, to really understand what are the streets that really work. They're close enough to the busy street, but they have low volumes. That's been a huge part of what we've, I think, been successful in doing. And the other piece, when you just look at the cost, you know, our total bikeway network that we've developed is about $60 million. That's what we've estimated the cost to be. You know, that's equivalent to one new urban freeway mile. So we think that, you know, developing our network is pretty cost effective. Just a couple cost examples so you can see why, again, I'm not trying to trash cycle tracks, but 1 mile of European cycle track, you know,
this cost estimate, and it could be 2.7 or it could be 20 million. You know, there's a huge range to it. But you know, cycle tracks are really great. I mean, separating the bicyclists from the roadway, especially on the busier streets, has a huge benefit. But the cost per mile is high. Our greenway projects are coming in at about $250,000 a mile. And you know, those of you that know the cost of transportation projects know that you know we're doing some cherry picking, and I'll explain that in just a minute, to get the cost as low as this. And you'll see some of what that is. And part of what I mean by that is crossing busy streets is difficult. And so one of the things, and Greg probably deserves as much credit for anybody on this in sort of the city, is if you look at low volume streets and you identify, wow, there's an existing pedestrian signal. There's a trail through a park that we could make work for bikes. Identifying those kinds of things can take a project from a $500,000 neighborhood greenway project to a $250,000 project. So as Greg will talk about more in a minute, we've doubled, or I think we're getting close to almost tripled, the number of neighborhood greenway miles that we have in the city of Portland. And we've been able to do that with still staying close to this $250,000 mile target just by really effectively identifying streets where we can minimize the costs associated with developing the greenway. Neighborhood greenways, pretty straightforward. If you remember four basic goals of what we were trying to accomplish with our neighborhood greenways, you'd be better than 99% of the people probably that work for PBOT in transportation, but you'd also be a good spokesperson for our neighborhood greenways. And the first one for us, and this one is a little bit controversial, is we would really like to see 1,000 motor vehicles or less on the street. And I think what we'd really like to see is 500 or less, maybe even 300. We're basically providing access on that street to people's houses that live on the street, to the garbage trucks, the delivery trucks, that sort of thing. But we want to minimize the amount of vehicles on the street. We want that trail-like experience. We don't want cars passing bikes. We want bikes being comfortable two and three abreast in the travel lane. We also are really working hard to protect the residential character of the neighborhood and improve safety. The nice thing about this one is when you go to a neighborhood meeting and it's mostly filled with people that are like, why are you here? My street's fine, leave me alone. And you say, hey, we're here because we want to make sure that there aren't more cars cutting through your neighborhood. People like that. So that's one with these streets that's been pretty effective, regardless of whether you never ride a bike. The next one for us is speeds at or under 20. This used to say speeds at or under 25. I feel really confident, and from lots and lots of bike rides and interactions we have with neighborhood, there's something pretty magic that happens when you reduce the 85th percentile speed from 25 to 20 miles per hour. It's just, not only is it much safer, but it's also just way, way more comfortable. And you know, you're talking to people, and cars are totally realize that it's inappropriate to pass people and pass bikes in the travel lane. But probably even more important than that, about this speed at or under 20 miles per hour, why we fought so hard to get the 20 mile per hour in the legislature speed limit, is we aggressively use speed bumps. And that's probably, if you ask Greg or if you ask me, the speed bump is the most important tool that we have in our toolkit for doing our neighborhood greenways. And the reason for that is it's super cost effective. It works really, really, really well. Even though we heard initially from some cyclists that said, oh, if you make, how many speed bumps am I going? What did you guess?
29
speed bumps over
3.2 miles.
It's nice to have someone with you as the numbers, right? That's a lot of speed bumps, and when we put them in, there were a lot of people at our open houses, and can't really answer the question until you've had a bunch of people ride on it, that said, I don't know if I'm going to be comfortable riding over 32 speed bumps every time I go to work, and that's my rep to get into work. Since we put that project in and done numerous rides, we've gotten almost, I can't count 5 complaints of people that ride those routes that complain, and we've made those routes time competitive. And that's this last bullet, efficient to get people where they want to go. So one of the things you'll see in a minute, part of the way that we do that is we flip a ton of stop signs. So like the Going project that I was talking about in a minute, it parallels a busy street, Prescott. Before we did this project, every other street you were stopping at a stop sign, or you weren't stopping as a cyclist, and you're pissing everybody off, and you're putting yourself maybe at risk. When we flip all the stop signs that we don't need, and basically, we need stop signs from a safety perspective at all the busy streets that we cross. Some of that we can figure out by classification, but even more than that, we just look at volume and speed of vehicles. And we with all of our projects, we apply the NCHRP 562 and the Zadir report for crossing safety through MEGCD, and we don't cut any corners. we apply the standard as the feds would like us to for crossing busy streets. And that's the one you can sort of see in this picture. As we got out and talked about these projects and we moved away from talking about bike boulevards to neighborhood greenways, you know, the reason that we've done that is one, that it's a different project, right? I mean, it's not just a sales pitch. We're investing at least as much money on our neighborhood greenways on improvements that directly benefit pedestrians of crossing busy streets where there's almost always a transit stop than we are doing other bike things, you know, traffic calming or sharrows or that kind of thing. So we've gotten tons of support from the equity community and from our pedestrian community just because of that. You know, a lot of the neighborhood greenway crossings are in locations where otherwise it was hundreds of yards to a signal, and now you have a pedestrian island or some other, you know, safe way to get across the street. So those are the basic four goals of our neighborhood greenways. I think the one, maybe one that's sort of hidden in the efficiently getting people where they go, is we really feel that it's that people need to be able to get around on neighborhood greenways without a map. So that map that we live in, it's a one-to-one scale, that has sharrows and the signs and everything else, you know, that's what, you know, you should be able to go out there and figure it out. You know, a map can help you, but we have sharrows basically everywhere there's a turn. You'll see that in the video in a minute. And we want signage so it's just really intuitive. We don't want people getting lost on our routes. So this slide gives you kind of an overview of what we see as the transformation between our bike boulevards and our neighborhood greenways. Again, the first one is we have a much lower, and if Greg and I could set the number, it would be 500 cars a day, but 1,000 cars a day, you know, seems about right. 3,000 cars a day is in Portland, I don't know what it is in Seattle, but in Portland, over 3,000, we want a bike lane. And so we used to say under 3,000, but we'll make it work. Now we kind of have this, you know, between 3,000 and 1,000, which is a little bit of a, you know, hard thing to figure out what you're gonna do, but we're aggressively trying to get our neighborhood greenways down to 1,000 cars a day, and that's mostly by picking good streets to start with. Speeds under 20 used to be that speeds under 30 were okay for neighborhood greenways. Crossing treatments, it used to be that as long as we had gaps of less than one per minute in peak hour, we were okay with that. Now we're basically every busy street, we're doing the NCHRP analysis to figure out what's needed. And you know, the NCHRP 562, it's safety, but even more than that, it's about delay. And so what you're looking at is you want a system, again, if we're gonna pull people off the busy street to ride on the neighborhood greenway and make that investment, it needs to be time competitive. And so flipping stop signs, making crossings of busy streets that work, again, so what NCHRP 562 does for you is it would say, based on the amount of congestion and the amount of crossing that you have, what do you need as far as rapid flash beacons or signalization so you minimize the delay of bicycles that are trying to get across the street. Again, you can see large sharrows, the stormwater planters, pocket parks, which we'll talk more about, and I think a huge piece for us, this is that streets designed for people riding side by side, is we are doing everything we can to make sure that people get that when they see a sharrow on our street in Portland, that they're in a place where they shouldn't be passing cars. And we're gonna do anything we can to make that work. This, how many people have heard of home zones? As many as I would have thought. So home zones is, I think mostly, it sort of came out of London or England, and the idea is creating these areas where it's 20 mile per hour within this like whole residential zone. And what's been shown to happen within those areas is very similar to what Greg was just talking about, is you see these dramatic decreases for all modes, the driver, the bicyclist, the pedestrian. Again, we see the biggest decreases for the younger age and for seniors. Again, we see the biggest safety increases for people driving cars. One of the things that's been great about our second round of outreach, or third year, I guess, of outreach on our neighborhood greenways, is we show this slide, and we show the video that you're gonna see in a minute at our open house for the first meeting. And it's kind of like this. We don't do open houses for our neighborhood greenways that are just posters and people can walk in and look at them. And, you know, that can work for certain kind of meetings. We feel like this is a new enough product, and we've had just a lot of really positive feedback. So this is, again, you know, what's working in Portland, is we do a presentation kind of like we're doing right now, maybe half as long. But before we get into a community conversation about the street, it just gets into this in great detail. And there's a lot of people's heads that I think when they came into the meeting and were like, these guys are gonna talk to me about bikes. They're gonna talk to me about stuff that I'm never gonna use. They're gonna talk to me about stuff that provides no benefits to me, right? they're going to screw with my neighborhood. All those sort of things. It's just kind of, it's not what people expect when they come to the meeting, and it's been really positive as far as people standing up and saying, wow, when I came to this meeting, there was a guy who stood up at the end of one of our meetings this summer and said, I came here with my buddies, and he was like 70, and his buddies were kind of about the same age. And he said, I came here with my buddies to rip you a new arsehole. And because you're going to screw up my neighborhood. And I've heard from you guys that what you're really going to do is keep cut through traffic off my street, slow down the speed, make it safer for kids to get to school, and everybody's going to be safer getting across the busy street. This is important for Portland. You know, it's just an important thing for us to be doing. And that's the kind of feedback we're getting and telling the story a little bit differently. Not that it's a slam dunk on every project. We still run into a lot of, you know, NIMBYism around everything that we try to do, but the tell me if I get into your slides. I might be able to transition.
No, you're good.
Okay. So the Neighborhood Greenway process, at least in Portland, this simple process that we have here is working really, really well. And just as a little bit more background, because I know there's a lot of implementers in the room. When we established this as a process, we went to our city council with a resolution, and we said, we just adopted the bike plan, we're going to kick off Neighborhood Greenways. We've heard from city council that they want us to implement this plan without wasting resources, but also do good community involvement. This is the pilot public input process that we're going to use. And city council said yes. And then when we went to neighborhood meetings, we showed this at every neighborhood meeting. When people say, I hate this project, or the process sucks, or whatever they're going to say, we say, look, this is the process council approved. It just helps, right? And I think it's a process that people have liked. So the first thing is we've identified the routes. For us, that mainly came out of the first phase was adopting our bike plan. So clearly having a bike plan is a great thing. Being able to update your bike plan can help with that as well. But when we come to the meeting, we say, these routes were identified over a three-year period, with massive public involvement. There's lots of opportunities to still tweak that and maybe, decide not to go forward with elements of this project. But there was a lot of history getting there, and that helps. We've learned through the School of Hard Knocks over the last couple of years that it's way better to over-notify people than under-notify people. Sending postcards is relatively inexpensive. And if you miss someone and they can, you didn't talk to me, sort of thing, it just sets you back so far. I think our lesson learned is, what do you think our average size mailings for this year's project?
Oh, 4,000 postcards?
Yeah, so per project, 4,000 postcards. Seems like a lot, but you're really clean as you're going into those public meetings. So then our first open house, like I said before, it's kind of like this. I mean, we do the first 20 minutes where we're just talking about, why do we care about safety? How do bike and ped projects benefit motor vehicles? That whole conversation that you just heard us talk about. And, what is a neighborhood greenway? And then we get into existing conditions. You'll see some slides in a minute where we kind of highlight what we're talking about there. That's all about, what are your volumes? What are your speeds? A little bit on crash history. How does it connect into the larger network? And then we get into specific concepts for improvements, and then a discussion with neighbors. And we used to, in our first open house, say we weren't going to talk about what the actual improvements were going to be. We wanted to first, talk about existing conditions, identify goals, and that sort of thing. What we learned is that kind of pissed people off and made them really paranoid, because they would say, we know you know what you're going to do, and you won't even tell us what you're going to do at this first meeting, and it also just kind of made things go slower, right? So based on that feedback, we said, you got some ideas, because we've been doing this for a while, and we know that some people are going to be like, how can you have an idea before you talk to us? But we still have learned over time that it's better to throw some of those ideas out there, because we kind of think we might know what they should be. And we've gotten really positive feedback on doing it that way. So then based on that, a month later, we have an open house that's scheduled. We come in and we basically say, here's what we heard from you. Based on that, we identify these five goals tied to those four goals that I talked about at the beginning. And we said, here's the improvements that we've done. Well, first, we ask people, do these goals make sense? Because our experience, I'm sure lots of you have done similar projects, if you ask people if the goals make sense, when you're just talking about the goals, might experiences 90% of the time you're good, right? If you talk about what the improvement's going to be that fits that goal, and then ask people if they're okay with the goals, well, if they don't like the improvement, they don't like the goal anymore, and you're kind of back in this circular thing. So our experience is, get people to agree to the goals, and then we start getting into the improvements, and as they argue against the improvements, we're like, okay, that improvement doesn't work, give us a better one. Or let's talk about what a better one might be, but the goal's locked in. And so you just, it's a, from our perspective, that's been a really productive way to do it. And then we, then based on that, and it's a little bit of a, you know, a nuanced conversation, but we, you know, we don't take a vote or anything. We say, okay, we, based on this feedback, we got a general sense, we're gonna put a report together and submit it to our transportation director. And basically, absent getting a letter from a neighborhood association that says we oppose this project, that's good, and we're done. And we implement the project. We do notification as we get ready for construction. If we get a letter from a neighborhood association that says we oppose this project, it almost doesn't matter what the reasons are. We're back in a process loop to kind of figure that out. Our city council, with this new process, doesn't want us to show up with a lot of opposition. And so again, that's a nuanced thing. We're not, you know, it does sort of make it seem like NIMBYs could jump up and say, well, we stacked the neighborhood meeting, and that's why we ended up, in, you know, with people opposing the project. We've been able to work through that, so that's been good.
Yeah.
I knew it was a slide, so I had to stretch it out.
And actually, I'm gonna next show us, or we'll do the video next. Now that we sort of talked about what neighborhood greenways are, we'll watch the street film video, and sorry to everybody that's already seen it, because I hope we can sit through again, okay? And then we'll talk some details about some of the projects we've done, and then wrap up. And start getting into the discussion.
Welcome to Portland. We're turning our bike boulevards into neighborhood greenways and working to create a citywide system that is great to live and play and get around by walking and biking. Our 25-year master plan for biking, we did a lot of research and we did a lot of focus groups about what it would take to get from 8 to 25% of all trips by bike. And what we learned is that bike boulevards, we also call them greenways, is the way to go. Over the next 5 years, we're going to be increasing the percentage of Portlanders that live within a half mile of a family-friendly bicycle pedestrian facility from less than 25% to over 80%. The main tool that we're using to achieve those outcomes is the Neighborhood Greenway Project.
So right now we're riding on the going Neighborhood Greenway. One of the things that we do to make these routes pleasant is we make sure cars are going slow. And we do that by installing speed bumps. On this route, we turned the orientation of 19 stop signs to make it a through route for bicycles. In addition, we put in 21 new speed bumps to make sure that we kept the speed down for cars. And then we put in some traffic barriers to make sure that there's not that many cars here in the first place.
Even in Portland, one of the biggest challenges to creating a family-friendly network is getting bicyclists and pedestrians across busy streets. At this crossing of the Going Neighborhood Greenway Project and Martin Luther King Boulevard, we extended the median island and allowed pass-throughs for bicyclists and pedestrians. It's made this project much easier and friendly and comfortable for people that are crossing this busy street.
Behind me is one of our guide signs that we use on our Neighborhood Greenway network to let people know where they're going. We show up to three destinations, how far it is, and how long it takes to get there. Our new signs that we started to use, we made the bicycle symbol a little smaller and the words bigger. This is a sheriff flower. We use it at the junction of our Neighborhood Greenway route so that people know that they have a decision to make. We're standing on the Concord Neighborhood Greenway where it meets the Bryant Neighborhood Greenway. And this is where they make up their mind.
A lot of our old bike boulevards had volumes that were over 1,000 cars a day. With our next generation neighborhood greenway projects, we're trying to get the volume of cars down to below 500 if possible. We're also going to be working in the state legislature to create a 20 mile per hour neighborhood greenway speed designation. If this passes, we'll be able to engineer our projects to a slower, more trail-like speed, which will increase the comfort and safety of cyclists and pedestrians.
Bike trains are a really great complement to the bike boulevards, and we've been really fortunate for the city's support in installing these bike boulevards that really make it safe to ride on.
and really welcoming for kids.
Last year, when safe routes to school brought bike education to the fifth graders here at Beach, I had three children, none of whom knew how to ride a bike. My fifth grader's teacher volunteered to try to help her learn while the other kids were learning bike safety. They started on Monday. By Wednesday, my fifth grader could ride a bike. By Friday, her brother in second grade could ride a bike. And 2 weeks later, her sister could ride a bike. And my husband got his bike out of the basement where I had lived for 20 years. And I got going on a bike again, and we're all riding. You can see all the bike racks we have behind. Those are all quite new. I've been here for 17 years, and we didn't have one bike rack when I first started here. So I think the most exciting thing is that a lot of our kids come here to learn because they've gotten fresh air, they've gotten exercise, they feel a part of our school community.
One of the other benefits of bicycle boulevards is using stormwater treatments in the design to not only calm traffic, but to also manage the stormwater that otherwise would be going into our sewer system.
You can see the green street managing stormwater, trees creating a better pedestrian and bike environment, and also cleaning the air and capturing stormwater. Speed bumps slowing traffic. We choose vegetation that's low to keep sight distances open. One of our workhorse species is juncus. Because of all of the dense vegetation at the bottom that when the water is flowing through the plants. When you're in Portland, you will see a diversity of Green Street projects. You'll see them being used as traffic diverters at 33rd and Going. You will see a new layout that we're using. This is the more traditional curb extension used to prevent basement sewer backups in little pockets of neighborhoods.
From Park's perspective, we like greenways because they can, first of all, connect existing open spaces or planned open spaces. But they can also provide a level of service in areas where we can't get a park. So if we don't have land in an area or it's too expensive in an area to build a park, we see the opportunity in working with the streets and adjacent to the streets in providing a level of amenity that reads and feels like a park. We also see some social benefits as well, I believe, because interacting with the neighbors, they're looking out for each other, and they're exercising.
Having it be on a residential street where it's really calm, it's a really great like social atmosphere where people can talk and get to know each other.
When I commute to work down the Going Street Greenway, I see people out walking in the street and like running in the street. People feel safer in any sort of transportation mode.
They're on a quiet street, where the stop signs are in their favor, where that bike boulevard is prioritized for the bike, not the car, for the pedestrian, not the car, and that it actually, in many cases, is the most reliable trip in terms of time travel, is the quickest trip when you include, you know, the time to park, is the cheapest trip when you include the cost of parking, and it's a trip that allows them to both get to work and exercise.
Up with us for this long. This is a long presentation. I wanted to just spend maybe 10 minutes talking some of our specific projects and the types of improvements that we do to make a neighborhood greenway happen. This example is the Concord Neighborhood Greenway. It's just a block west of Interstate Avenue, which carries a light rail, a train, and a lot of commercials happening on that street. So when we think about creating our neighborhood greenway network, It's about creating direct connections between schools, parks, and providing access to business and transit. And so we're going to parallel that busy street, you know, in terms of access to business and transit. This street also has an elementary school, which is actually the one highlighted in the video, Beach Elementary, which a few years ago the principal actually said that children were not allowed to ride their bikes to school. Last May we had 120 children riding their bikes down the neighborhood greenway to school together. And it's a pretty good thing. And they're riding that pretty often. That guy in that video, Kyle Johnson, actually, was thanks for sending him from Seattle. He started the bike train thing here in Portland, and I really appreciate it. You can't have him back. But in selecting our streets, the Concord was a great example because these are all of our data points along the street. or for streets that we're crossing when we're at a busy one. And these numbers tell you, you know, how many cars are going north, how many are going south, and how fast they're going. And through this corridor, we're looking at like 200 to 500 cars a day. And they're going 23 to 27 miles an hour. So this is a great starting place for us. And there's some things about it that make it work. One is, this is a big street that's going, that's actually a U.S. freight route right here. It has a pedestrian bridge over it that aligns with Concord. Right? So it's a natural break for car traffic. We already let bikes and pedestrians through, filtering through, not cars. So we already had that bridge in place that stopped that. Up there, we put in that traffic barrier that's a, Mark says maintainer, I say barrier. We have to get our message down, I guess. It's a large island that goes through the intersection, does not allow cars to go straight through or turn left. It's just right in, right out. Very wide island, it's 10 feet wide. If I'm walking with a stroller, it's wide enough I can take refuge on it. We actually changed the transition and the lane so you crisscross with one lane. So it's a pretty interesting project. It's about a $50,000 project. And then we installed speed bumps through the corridor to traffic calm to 20. A share marking every 250 feet. This project here is about 3 miles long, and it costs us about $100,000, right? And it has to do with really thinking about what it connects, how it connects, and what it doesn't connect to motor vehicles, and what those existing conditions are.
So, $100,000 per mile, $100,000 for the project.
Right, the project is 100, maybe 120. But that barrier island there was our biggest investment. It's about a $50,000 investment. And then we're spending about $2,200 a speed bump. Share markings are $200 a pop. So it's a really cost-effective project. The next project I wanted to highlight is one that we're actually just building our first traffic safety pocket park. So one of the concepts of in my mind, my heart, letters when I think about it. So what we're doing here is, you know, we're creating a trail-like experience through our neighborhoods. And one of the things we really want to do is create community and bring people together. And so one of the things I do is, like, I facilitate these things called intersection repair projects where people can paint their intersections. So on the street at 8th Avenue, they painted the largest one so far. This thing's massive. If you Google 8th and Holman, you can see a video of kids and neighbors out painting this thing that's about 120 feet long and covers the entire street. I mean, it's just beautiful. But here at 13th, what we're doing, there was this existing little pocket park right here. It was the size of one house lot. They had taken a house down and turned it into a little pocket park eventually. And neighbors actually are getting together for a potluck here the last Wednesday of every month in nice weather. And so what we're doing is we're taking the footprint of that park. We're bringing it. The Neighborhood Greenway goes like this, right? So what we're doing is we're bringing that park all the way across the street. So we're tripling the community space. And it'll have a bike path through it, some sidewalk connection improvements. It'll have stormwater facilities. This park is a collaboration between the community, transportation, Bureau of Environmental Services on the stormwater. Parks Bureau is doing the plantings design. Water Bureau is doing a water fountain for it. And it's partially funded by an EPA stormwater grant. Six agencies, right? Well, five agencies in the community. Which also is a really nice thing to pull together. And you can see, you know, those black things there, those are all new speed bumps. We're turning stop signs on it to make it a through route. We're installing a traffic barrier also at 33rd Avenue. It's kind of one of these, what I call a barrier island. One of these large islands goes all the way through the intersection, similar to that picture you saw at Concord. And then the other barrier here is at 13th. And of course, building a park is a little more expensive. But next month, this Sunday, is our last Sunday Parkways of the year. And we wanted to really get the capital done on this because Sunday Parkways will introduce the city of Portland to their new pocket park. It goes right through here. And the whole Neighborhood Greenway goes here, and this year we're doing a process on the Neighborhood Greenway that will be on this street, Durham. So you're starting to see a network come together. We do look at stormwater. We have a problem in our city. People poop, and there's a lot more people pooping. And the pipes can't handle it, because the pipes have that and the stormwater. and so they don't have enough capacity. So we just had to build this 22-foot in diameter thing we call a big pipe that costs $1.4 billion, right? And we don't really want to build another one of those things. It doesn't really do much for people's lives. It's a lot of money. And so, you know, as we get more people, we need to do things to make those pipes last longer. And one of the ways we can do that is to reduce the amount of stormwater that's going in, right? And take some of that demand off the pipes. So what we're doing is when we build a curb extension, instead of it being concrete, we're building these like introduced wetlands we call bioswales or green streets, right, that manage the stormwater on site. Anytime we build an extension of a curb at all, if there's water flowing to it, we have a city policy that says we need to manage that stormwater on site when we can. There's places where we can't because of the types of soils and those kind of things, but where we can, we want to do that. It makes it prettier. It does a really nice cooling effect. And we have over 1,000 bioswales now. And that's having a major effect on a lot of really great factors for our city. And one of them is to really create a network.
Greg, why is that stop bar so far back?
So this is a traffic control question from David. Is we have a stop bar here, right? This white line is where people are supposed to stop, right? But sometimes we have what's called an advanced stop bar, right? So a lot of times if you're in a two-lane street and someone's going to turn left from one street onto the street you're on, the traffic engineer might take that stop bar and do the one in that lane kind of further back, car stop here, people are going to go left, right, and have space to do that. This is sort of playing on that concept where what we want to do is bring the bicycle forward to take advantage of the shadow of that curb extension, benefit from it, get that visibility between those users. So this is an advanced stop bar for bicycles. So what we do, and actually this wound up having a stop bar, the stop bar went all the way across. We do want bikes to stop before a pedestrian crossing. And then they get a little box right here. It's an advanced stop bar. So they get the benefit of that curb extension to position them in that place. And people actually use it when you show them through that design to get them positioned there. This is an example that kind of combines a lot of things. And you saw it in the video when it was just installed. It said 33rd and Going. Going is a neighborhood greenway route. There's Going right here. And Going, if I was taller, I could point all the way up there. It goes off to the right. And this 33rd Avenue carries about 25,000 cars a day, a lot of cars. Right. So our challenge was to get cyclists from here to there. You know, thinking about a seven-year-old girl on a bike, I don't want her out here. Right. So what we did is we built a two-way raised bike path that just very short one connects here to there, and then they have a straight crossing up top. It does not allow cars to enter from the main street onto Going. So this is a large curb extension, like a semi-barrier, semi-diverter. That's a bioswale. It's huge, right? It's beautiful. And it doesn't allow cars to turn in off of Going. Cars can only go out. Now there, because it's actually the top of the hill, it's gray, it's concrete, but a large curb extension there does not allow cars to go through. And so what happens is the bicyclists on the neighborhood greenway route use this to make that offset connection. And it has a large bioswale here, and also up top there too, actually right above that crosswalk, there's a second swale. This is a picture of the pocket park. So this is what we're hoping it looks like in real life. It's kind of a beautiful picture. But you can see it's got swales on the corners here. It's got this bike path going through. There's a driveway here that we had to maintain access for, so some bollards in there that really create that space that's car-free. I won't be surprised if by next summer the neighbors are painting that space. I'm encouraging them. And they're talking about a square dance to the ribbon cutting. So equity, as we mentioned, is really important. When we look at crash data, East Portland is not benefiting like the rest of the city, for example. It's where we have the highest amount of poverty, highest amount of diversity. You know, we have about 25% of our population lives there. 38% of school-age children, right? So a lot of kids, you know, that have lower income, less options for your family, a lot more walking, and in a place that was annexed in the city, kind of like the northern part of your city, where, you know, it just is built to a different standard, a lot bigger streets, bigger sidewalks, all that kind of stuff. And one of the things that's really important is from a supply and demand side. So there's one piece that's just about justice, right? It's about, you got to serve a whole city. You know, we're not just serving where we got people riding already. We gotta serve, we gotta get that kid safely to school. The second thing is about economics, right? If all we do is serve a little portion of the city with these really great walking and biking places, it becomes a supply and demand problem, right? And so the more that we can increase the supply, we can take some pressure off that demand side and deal with some of those problems that we get when we just focus on small pieces of the city. So with our neighborhood greenway system, we're really focused on those questions. I'm going to show you three maps citywide and a couple just on our area of the city real quick. So we began our traffic calming stuff in the early 90s, right? So some of these routes that are green here were actually built just as traffic calming. And then the 1996 bike plan happens and they get rebranded as a bike boulevard, right? Now they're getting rebranded as a neighborhood greenway. But they're going to change. We'll update them to perform better. What we see on this map is what was completed by 2002, right, of what was called bike boulevards, our first generation facilities. 24% of houses are within a half mile of this network. And this is the whole city, see what serves. You know, kind of inner southeast Portland has the best network rolling. A couple other projects, but that's about it. And this is kind of what over time proves to be where we see the most families and diverse people out there riding, not just sort of what that 1% that's going to be fearless and out there no matter what and all that kind of stuff, but a really good cross-section. Another interesting thing about Southeast, the Hawthorne Bridge is pretty famous for having a lot of bike traffic, and there's no bike lanes going to it. It's all these green routes. It's all these neighborhood greenways that are feeding that. Those are our highest demand facilities that are driving, you know, to 7,400 bikes crossing that bridge a day and 1.59 million crossings last year. I'll say that slower because I get excited. 1.59 million crossings last year. I like that. Okay, so I now dimmed what we had up until 2002. We did nothing until 2009. This is what our system will look like by the end of this calendar year, except this line. This line is the 20s. It's a federally funded project, so we'll begin working on that. So it's on this map because it's funded. So you exclude that line. This is what we've accomplished in the last 2.5 years. What's that? This is just over 50. We've been busy, my wife kind of missed it. And so, what's that? But Mark and I get to spend more time together. So this is what our system will look like. Soon. And this is what our vision is for 2015. So we really, except for down here. This part right here, we're still kind of getting the details through. Anyway, that's kind of our vision. So I wanted to just focus on a neighborhood, just give you a sense for what this means for everyday life. This is basically Northeast Portland, and a little bit of north. And this is with no neighborhood greenways at all, right? So these lines here, black lines, are bike lanes. And that's all I'm showing on this map, streets and bike lanes. And this is what it looked like as of 2002, right? We didn't begin projects here and start really building until 2010. And this is what it will look like by the end of this calendar year, except for this line, right? So you can see we're starting to get a real network and really useful network for people to be able to get places and know that they can get around their city to do their everyday things. I'm sorry. And then this is what it will look like by the end of next summer. So now you're starting to get a really complete sort of thing. We'll probably be done for a little bit. There's one more project that'll probably get added right about here, north-south, in the next few years. But beyond that, once we fill in this 9th Avenue here, it's a pretty robust network that's happened. This has happened in about a 3-year period. When you have a product, and I sound like a salesman. When you're selling the widget, when you have a system like a neighborhood greenway, where you're going to people and say, look, I've heard from you that you are concerned about the number of people driving fast in front of your house, and that you're scared about having your kid cross that busy street, and gosh, trees are kind of cool. And you're actually hearing them. And in the process, I mean, we've had a number of routes, but we've actually changed the route a little bit based on feedback. And it's ownership and programming on top, bringing fun things like, you know, Sunday Parkways, and doing it with a system that's relatively low cost, you know, you're able to start to actually have effect in a way so that's meaningful. And so I'm, as you can tell, kind of excited. And I'm really excited that Seattle's taken this charge about neighborhood greenways because, I think that if we're able to do it in more cities and make it a real movement and start to really transform some of the ways we think about what we do with our streets and how we live in them, we can start to have momentum and bigger things, you know, like get funding and create real programs and actually do this stuff. So thank you so much for being here and for organizing in Seattle.
Department leaders, business leaders, and I saw the greenways, and my life was transformed. And it's one of those things where I've been riding my bike in Seattle for a long time, and I have recently moved downtown. My husband and I live in 1,000 square feet down here, and I do not like riding my bike downtown because I don't feel safe. Many of you do. One of my colleagues on City Council, Mike O'Brien, he rides his bike everywhere, in the rain, in his tuxedo, he will go, right? Me, I want to have more protected lanes. And in June of this year, a number of us went to Copenhagen with ISIS staying. And I saw what another country has done. And Copenhagen looked like we did about 30 years ago. It was not a bicycle-friendly city. And in 1978, Copenhagen citizens stood up and said, we want more bike lanes because it's going to be more economical for us to get around. It's actually going to be faster. And at the end of the day, they now have the most amazing system where you can drive or ride your bike on virtually every street, separate from cars and trucks on all the major throughways. They have about the same population we do, albeit it is flatter than we are. Their weather is worse, and 37% of the people ride their bike to work every day. And about 33%, even in the winter, even in the snow. It's an incredible thing. What I want to do in our city is to do what Portland has done. And the fact that you have been able to do this in less than 5 years is so inspiring to me, and I know we can do it as well. We have a number of people from SDOT here, and I want to tell you that our Seattle Department of Transportation, they are working on this. I'm very thankful to Sarah, who took us on a ride today. A number of people came with us, and I don't know if you know Sam Woods, but Sam is here as well. And what I want to do, and as a member of your city council, what I am pledging to do, is to make sure that these neighborhood greenways become as real as what Portland has done. It is really my goal for the next few years while I'm on the council. I also recognize that there are frankly two groups of bicyclists right now. There are my Mike O'Brien type. Mike O'Brien is what we call fast and fearless. And then there are people like me that are, I think the term is willing but wary. So if we recognize that the system has to work for all of us, and then focusing on what I think Greg and Mark have shown so well, that this isn't about bicycles, this is about safety for all of us. And I know The Stranger last week had written something about declaring war on cars, and I think that's just the wrong metaphor for us. The metaphor ought to be safety for all of us, whether we're walking, whether we're riding our bike, whether we're driving our car or a truck or a scooter, that we all have a safe place to be. So that's my goal. And Greg and Mark, you are just so inspiring to me. I mean, just seeing this again, I could watch that video 100 times. But the good news is we are continuing this conversation tomorrow with SDOT and with leadership all the way from Peter Hahn's office to his directors. The mayor is engaged in this. Obviously, you've got 9 city council members right now who are bike advocates. And this is really the best news for our city, is that you've got elected leaders that really want to make this work. So I'm going to step back now and open it up for questions. And I really hope this will be a dialogue because Greg and Mark are here and they are, as you know, fantastic. So anyway.
I think that one of the reasons that we didn't build anything for a long time is that people might say, why are you doing this to me, right? I don't ride a bike, you know, it's them and me and, you know, that kind of stuff. I think part of the success of the Neighborhood Greenway strategy is to say to people, it's about you, and this is for you, and this is about making your street a better place to live. In a way that concept of bike boulevard, when our first round of projects, I mean, the Neighborhood Greenway thing came in kind of not, you know, after we were going with this stuff. And, you know, even this the way that we're doing these projects has changed through time and gotten better, I think, from when we first started launching our very first ones, these next generations. And when we start transitioning from bike boulevard to Neighborhood Greenway in kind of the way we talk about these, it changed the whole dynamic of the whole conversation. And it got us the same product, right, actually a better product, right, because of all the stuff we're doing, but we're able to do it. The conversation shifted from about bikes doing this and that, and why are you doing this, and why are you spending money on that, to thank goodness you're here, and doing the things that we care about. So, you know, that messaging is important if you want to actually do something.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, two things along that, I think things you'll hear as you implement Neighborhood Greenways, because we hear them a lot, kind of on that same topic is, you'll hear from some cyclists, I think it's similar to the, what was your term for the 1%er?
The willing, the wary, the fast and
fast and the furious. Is part of what they would say, and these are, you know, well-meaning bike advocates, right? They would say things like, before we did these projects, yeah, everybody knows there's back streets you can use. you know, of course, you know, why would you spend money on something like that? It's already pretty safe, how many crashes are there, right? And it's sort of that nudge concept, right? Which is really profound, right? Why are people getting all these maps to figure this stuff out? It's because they can't figure it out without a map. But we don't want people having to figure it out with a map. We want people to be able to figure it out on the street and people travel around our city. So that's one thing you'll hear. Just one other quick one is, and this is kind of crazy, it is as you start getting these projects. One of the things we heard a lot, similar to like, speed bumps are going to be bad, was, what about all those people coming out of their driveways? I mean, we heard this from people who have been working on the bike issue for years in our departments. And it's like, well, have you thought about businesses and driveways? You know, I mean, the amount of people coming out of the individual residential driveways is nothing like a commercial street. So it's a good point. It just doesn't have any application. But again, those kinds of issues, those kinds of issues will come up a lot from bike people, right? Or bike ped people. So it's there are. It was a fight to get the bike people to say, yeah, it'd be okay to call these things neighborhood greenways.
You're hiding bikes. Ghettoizing bikes, and now you're taking the word bike out.
The Backstreet Boys.
Yeah, yeah. Can't sing.
Yeah, back there. That's you.
Yeah. Greg, I'm from Wallingford. And one thing that struck me about the mayor talking in the video is a lot of what he was talking about is making it quick for bikes, stop sign prioritization.
Right.
I mean, how important is that in your vision of making these?
Super important, but it's not as controversial as people might think. Because when we say that, we're not saying we're going to run low-volume streets across busy streets and stop the busy street. What we're saying is all those stop signs that really are just there because you have a traditional stop sign grid, every other street with a stop sign, though, if this is an arterial for bikes, and it serves a lot of pedestrian functions, but it just, we wouldn't put stop signs on every other street on an arterial for cars, we shouldn't do it for bikes. So it ends up, there's a lot of it that we do, it hasn't really been controversial for two reasons. One, we're hardcore about, we're slowing your speed, right? If we were flipping stop signs and we weren't doing speed bumps, I'd be super uncomfortable with it, and I think people in the neighborhood would be too. But because we're saying, your speed's gonna go down, this is how we're gonna measure it, or if we don't achieve this goal, we're gonna do more traffic calming, you know, add another speed bump. But because of that, then people aren't freaking out. We haven't had really any pushback on the stop sign flipping. I think it's mostly been because of that, that people are confident that we're slowing their speeds down. And we don't do it on busy streets.
My name is Dawn, I live in Ballard, and I've been working on the last 6 years to build a park boulevard on 14th Avenue West. One of our biggest issues is that this street, we have a number of streets in Ballard, this is one of them that's designated in arterial, even though it may be less than 1,000 cars a day. So did you have any issues in Portland where you wanted to build a greenway on what was technically arterial and we had to de-arterialize it?
I can't think of it. I mean, for us, it's really, it's kind of
so
weird.
Unusual.
It's unusual, but it's, for us, if we have that situation, we went to our city traffic engineer and said, this is the street we want because it's lower volume, the arterial classification wouldn't get in the way. The only thing that might have a relationship to that is emergency response routes. So in Portland, we have emergency response routes. I assume you guys have that network here too. We can't do speed bumps on emergency response routes unless they're fire-friendly, which we're doing some experiments with right now, but we don't have one. We have one that works great for fire, it just doesn't slow cars down. But so anyway, that's the only issue for us that we sometimes run into. I mean, this is where we go crazy, you know, like they're building bike plan and somebody who's not a big bike Neighborhood Greenway sort of person puts a Neighborhood Greenway on emergency response route. So Greg and I freak out. You can't do that to us. We can't traffic calm them. We can't flip stop signs or all that sort of stuff. So that's the one for us that we run into. But arterial classification, we just look at volumes.
Good. Thank you.
My name is Jeremy. I live in Madison Valley. And I
wanted
to comment on something that you said, which was, you know, I bike to work and I got bike on the back streets, but I'm finding that there are a lot of cars that are taking these back routes to avoid traffic on the arterials. And I think what I like about this is that, and I know, I guess the question is, how the people who aren't using them as for bike travel are, how much is the average Portland citizen aware of, you know, like, well, I'm going to avoid Alberta because that's the, I'm just reading your map, I mean, like, that they know what the bike streets are, and so then they're going to, their routes change accordingly, and so that there's the you know, there's,
so
they're not going to be
so
traveling. I like the separate, I mean, it is a,
yeah,
access,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, the, basically, it's a system, right? So, you know, there's sort of things that are playing off each other. So we're turning stop signs that are creating time competitive routes for someone on a bicycle. We don't want to increase the amount of car trips. So what we do is we create friction, right? So put in speed bumps to slow you down, right? You're gonna be better off on that busy street, right? We sometimes put in a physical barrier, right? So when someone's in Portland, they're driving their car and they see that sheriff on a residential street, I want them to have the expectation that somewhere up the road there, I'm not gonna be able to keep going, right? This is not a convenient road for me to be on. And coupled with that friction is the more that we increase the amount of people walking and biking, the more that people wanna say, I'd rather not drive there. And so it really, you know, you think about traffic in sort of two baskets, local and through. And so, you know, local trip is I'm on a busy street, my house right over there, you know, I'm gonna just drive my house, right? A through trip is through one of these streets is, you know, my work's over here, my house is 10 miles that way, I'm in the middle here, there's congestion on this busy street, so I'm gonna hop over to this little residential and cut down that for a couple miles to avoid that congestion. It's a through trip. So what we want to do is break up that through trip. You know, the local trip, someone might have to go a block out of direction to get to their house, at most or something like that, but really managing about local and through and eliminating as much as possible those through trips.
So we did, people have been in Portland, have seen the first generation bike boulevards had markings that were like this big, dinner plate size. And it was exactly because of the thing you're talking about. You know, really good, smart implementers were saying, we only want bikes to know. It's kind of a secret, you know, we don't want cars going on these streets. Now, our strategy now is, you know, how long are you going to keep that secret going as you get to 15%, 20% mode split, right? It's just not going to work. Our strategy is we're going to tell people where they are, and we just had one, our going project. The volumes went up from
500 cars.
350 to 450, we put in a diverter in a spot where, and people were like, why are you doing it? We had people freak out. Like, they were, you can't do it now, why can't you do it now? It's like, never going to be easier. We just finished the meetings, people want this target, and we did it. So that's the other thing, we're measuring. And if we see cut-through traffic, you know, we'll stop
it. And in that case, specific on that one there, we did talk about it in our open house process.
Yeah.
And at the time, the neighborhood was pushing for it, like, hey, you know, we think we might have a problem here. Can you put in one here? And we didn't have the budget at the time, so we said, hey, we do these other elements, let's see how it goes. Oh, you guys are right. Okay, we'll do it. It's not a very expensive treatment. We can get it done.
How many bicycles do you have on that ongoing?
Going now, we're, I think, 1,200. It tripled in the first 2 months. It was, you know, people started using it right away.
To follow up on that question, are you seeing an increase in through traffic on adjacent streets that are parallel to the...
So where we're doing a neighborhood greenway, and we put in a barrier, we look at the system and say, gosh, this street adjacent to it might potentially get a little bit of traffic. There's two things about that. One is, we're starting with streets that are low volume, right? Like the Concord example I showed you, you're dealing with 300, 500 cars a day. You're basically dealing with local trips on that street to start, so what we want to do is protect that, right? So when you put in a traffic barrier on something like that, if you're moving, you know, 10% of that or something like that, you know, you're talking about 30 cars, 50 cars, that starts getting dispersed through the network, you don't even feel it, right? So one of the really important strategies is starting with a low volume street, much less threat to adjacent streets. The second thing is that we look at how we can mitigate. So if we have an adjacent street, we're hearing concern about that, you know, we might increase the number of stop signs on that street. And when we measure it, we see a real speeding problem, we might install speed bumps, you know, to start. And then we go back and take after counts, and if it's, you know, we see something significant happening, we'll try to address that. So we haven't seen it as a problem. The biggest one we've moved so far was went from 1,500 cars down to 200 cars. And given the circumstances of all the things that happened in the roadway network there, we didn't introduce problems.
Greg and I made it just so we don't sugarcoat it too much. There's some federal projects that we have right now where we're moving cars and we're involved in them, but we're not managing them. And you're going to have projects like that where you just can't make the connection without taking a street that's 3,000 and bringing it down to 1,000. And, you know, we have one going on right now, they're just hard.
Hi, I'm Genevieve from Fremont, and I noted when I was in Portland a few years ago that the speed limit signs seem to have very large numbers, and it says speed kind of small and limit kind of small, but you see a great big 20 or 30, and here it seems that our numbers are this big, then we've got the dinner plate, you know, number, and then big speed and limit, as if you don't already know that those words exist. So I was just curious if you have the facts on that signage in comparison, or what your sizes are there, because it seems that bringing down the speed is like very important to safety.
Yeah. You don't want the technical answer. Oregon had speed zones, a basic rule for a long time until 2003. It was basically a suggested speed.
Just asking about the sign.
I get it. Yeah. And so in Oregon, the sign does not say speed limit. It says speed 30.
Right.
So that's a standard. Because it wasn't a speed limit until 2003, then it changed, but we just kept the signs.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Jennifer from Ballard. Do any of your greenways go through commercial districts, or are they strictly residential? Because I know one of the routes that we're considering in Ballard would skirt the commercial area, not on the main drag, but through some of the streets that have businesses.
So typically we would cross it. And we're going to so there's two things. One thing is where we have a route that's paralleling a commercial area, we'll put in a sign eventually that says, you know, Ballard Business District that way, and then put a bike route, you know, right there. So you go one block, you have a high capacity parking, you park your bike, you're in the middle of that business district. So that's a really low cost, easy strategy for making that connection. Or we're crossing through it, you know, and maybe put a bike corral there when you're crossing at that junction. We have our highest volume, most difficult one probably for us to deal with is going to be our Clinton Neighborhood Greenway, which today has 3,200 cars a day. And has two commercial nodes that are on it. We can't really support those businesses and take 2,000 cars away from being in front of them. You know, that amount of friction between the bike and the car, you know, it doesn't have that same level of comfort. So, you know, our preference really is not to be on the street of commercial, but just off of it or coming through it.
It doesn't mean we wouldn't do improvements there.
Yeah.
You know, we need people need to get to the businesses. And ultimately, as we get our mode share up, we're going to be doing cycle tracks and other kinds of things where we can have real separation and start to really pencil out the mode split. I guess the thing I just, the thing we kind of keep asking ourselves when we look at those is, if you're the kid riding to school, or the group of kids riding to school, if the only route is through the business district, and it's 2,000 cars a day or 3,000 cars a day, you know, bonus, make it as good as you can make it. But if a block away there's a street that's 200 cars a day, why not do both? Because the ones that the, doing, putting the sharrows on the parallel street and making that so it works for families and the people that just don't want to ride through the business district during rush hour or whatever else, it's just a really, I think, cost-effective way of building that part of the network. It's not like we want to ignore the busier streets and the commercial areas and those kinds of things, but ideally you want that route. Why not have that route that works even in congested periods? Right?
See, the issue with this particular area is that to get through the sort of commercial area of Ballard, the only choice is for going through the across the arterials, taking
right.
there. So
okay.
if you don't cross at 57th Street, that is kind of your only way to get across 24th Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
58th Street is your only way to get across 15th Avenue.
Right.
And there's about three blocks of commercial in between.
Right. So what we'd want to
so
do if we did that, either way, there's like real world challenges like that all over the place. What we want to do is we just want to, you know, if it turns out that it's this fairly, you know, 15 block section, what it would be. Are you shorter? Then we would just traffic calm, we'd work like crazy to figure out how we could, you know, share that thing a lot, traffic calm it, whatever we need to do so there's no confusion, right? This is a place where it's like a trail crossing, you know, having to go on a busy road and then make a transition or something like that.
If it wasn't a major merch response route, we'd be looking at traffic calming. If there's width, we'd be looking at buffer bike lanes or
cycle
crossing
sharrows.
Yeah, I mean, it's, yeah, so.
Lots of green paint.
Yeah, it's always case specific.
Yeah, back there in front.
Hi, Sandra from Ravenna, and the topography of Seattle is in general steeper than Portland, and our streets, I'm pretty sure, are in general narrower. So in your experience putting in neighborhood greenways and other bike infrastructure, have there been places where you've had to work with steeper streets and narrower streets, and how have you dealt with those?
Can I start with myself on this? Sure. Well, first, just break those two apart. I think the easier one first. Narrow streets haven't been a problem for us. In fact, they're sort of naturally traffic calm. And so that works. I mean, hear it a lot. Like, how does this work for a narrow street? When I say that, I don't mean to be flip about it. If there's a narrow street and it's acting like an arterial, high speeds and high volumes, that's a different story. But most of our narrow streets aren't like that. So narrow streets hasn't been a problem for us. Grade issues is a big problem in primarily in Southwest Portland, because it's Southwest Portland is a lot more like, you know, a lot of Seattle, those sales downtowns are more challenged than Portland's as far as, you know, grades. This is one I think where there's still a lot of, you know, learning that we need to do. I think the electric assist bike actually over the long term is gonna be a really big deal for people, and it's gonna be explode. You know, our neighboring greenways, especially some of our ones in the hillier areas, they're really comfortable, but one way out of your trip, like in my case, when I ride home, you know, I'm climbing 500 feet, right? And, older I get, tired I get at the end of the day at work, electric assist would make that pretty nice. I'd have a trail-like experience all the way home on neighborhood greenway type routes, or I'm just gonna have to go a little bit slower. I think the only other thing I throw out there related to that is, I think one of the things we're starting to hear, especially like in my part of town in Southwest, is people on bikes need to, be willing to walk a short distance to make a really great route. So I can tell you, like the street that I live on, there's like a 100-foot section to it where a fair number of people have to walk, you know, to get to the top of this hill, like my son would. But after doing that, this 2-mile section is virtually car-free. And so a lot of times I think we would say, well, I'm never gonna send someone toward a grade where they might have to walk for that much time. Think about the time it takes to walk up that 100-foot hill and the time it takes to wait in a busy signal, right? The delay is not that much different. But as cyclists, I think we have this, and again, well, lesson learned, we'll have to figure out if this is really true, but we have this sort of idea, if I had to walk the same amount of time that I had to wait at a signal, this route will never work, right? And I think that's something we got to sort of question in some of our hillier places. There might be places where you walk up a, you know, a sidewalk or whatever you have to do, but our rails, you guys have all these stairs, right? We've been doing a lot more projects, I'm sure you've done them here, but where you put the
the rail in next to the stairs so you can walk your bike up the stairs. And in some cases, you know, that could be a reasonably long way, but if you look at the total length of the trip, the experience you're gonna have on the trip, things like that, I think we're gonna have to kind of rethink some of those assumptions because they can be really good routes.
The other piece I'd like to just add to that real quick, because I know Hill's really important, is if you think about who we're doing this for, which is everybody, right? You know, the kids are living in Seattle neighborhoods. They're walking and biking around Seattle neighborhoods. They're getting up those hills, you know. They're doing these things where they're riding the bike and getting off and walking when they need to and all those kind of things. So, you know, what this does is it strengthens that and it protects that. And it creates that experience for that person. The other quick thing I'd like to add about residential safety, particularly pedestrians, is when you look at residential traffic safety, the most important factors are speed and volume on a residential street. Some of the most aggressive pedestrian safety projects in the world, things like the Von Erichs in the Netherlands and the Play Streets in Germany and all these, they took sidewalks out. If they had sidewalks, they removed them, right? And what they focused on was reducing speed and reducing volume. Sidewalks are incredibly expensive to build. You know, $1 to $8 million a linear mile. We have one project right now, it's 0.8 miles, $19 million, right? So, you know, you get a lot more bang for your buck for safety and comfort by spending your sidewalk money on big, busy streets and on your residential streets, really focusing on reducing speed and volume to be able to deliver a system. And so those narrow streets actually can be a benefit in that way because they aren't places that people are gonna wanna drive, especially if you slow them down further. So they can actually be a really great safety enhancement, particularly for pedestrians.
That's good.
Can
you share
over here? Oh, yeah. So I live, my name is Bob, and I live over at Madison Park. So we have a road that goes through the Arboretum, which is completely suicidal for any bicyclists.
Oh, really?
It's very attractive for all bicyclists, and a lot of novice cyclists get into that and find themselves in a situation that they're not comfortable in.
Yeah.
But the experienced cyclists know how to go through the neighborhood around that.
Yeah.
But only the most experienced cyclists know that route.
Right.
Yeah. Do you have any tricks to keep people away from the most attractive but dangerous options?
Generally, it's, you know, we think the marking's going to help and that experience is going to help. So, you know, in terms of the infrastructure informing that person's choices, you know, if I'm following Cheryl's on my bike ride and they take me to this route that all these other guys know about that you're using today that are avoiding that road. Oh wow, this is much better, you know? So, you know, providing sort of a route and a guide that takes you through that safe place. And, you know, in our experience, Hawthorne Boulevard is a street that is sort of the center of inner southeast Portland. The Hawthorne district is sort of known as like the bikey part of Portland. Hawthorne stinks to ride a bike on, you know, it's really busy street, there's no bike lanes, very narrow lanes, all this kind of stuff, very stressful. But what you have are two neighborhood greenways, the Sam and Taylor one, the Lincoln Harris one, parallel it. Since those have gone in, we've seen bike crashes on Hawthorne go down. And we've seen ridership on these parallel routes blow up. I mean, they're just huge. Because people know what they are, you should guide them to be there, and then it's a comfortable and intuitive experience. So
just a couple of quick, we have family-friendly routes and family-friendly maps. I think Seattle probably has something similar, maybe, or not.
Not good.
Oh, yeah. The other thing we've done is, you know, most people that work in the government, especially engineers, are gonna be uncomfortable with saying, this is safe, and this is not safe.
Oh, yeah.
So what we've done, which I think is a nice workaround, especially with the translation sort of issues, is, and then we've done this a lot on our state process school maps. We need maps that like work regardless of your language and are really intuitive. And what we came down with was smiley face, squiggly face, and sad face. You can have a bike on a busy street and we'll code it under the color sad face, right? Because for, you know, I mean, a really busy street, right? Or, you know, and we might have one that's kind of middle and it's kind of a squiggly face. But we do some of that kind of stuff to try to get that information out as well on the sign. We have done it on the signs.
We'll only put smiley faces on signs.
I think it's going to come back to my thing of we need to make this intuitive for people without maps.
Yeah,
so I think it's a good point.
Let's get to the back.
What's happened with bike racks and the kind of infrastructure that needs to support bicycling for transportation instead of bicycling for sport?
Sure. I used to manage bicycle parking for the city of Portland, and we've installed a couple thousand bike racks last couple of years. The big thing I think we do that's a little different is we do a lot of what are called bike corrals, where we convert a little bit of car parking into bike parking right on the street. And so, we're looking at, we can take, when you look at business and a car trip, that car parking space, they say, is about 1.5 customers. We can take that same space and give them 20 customers and give them space for their employees and those kind of things. It also, the nice thing about that is instead of storing the bikes on the sidewalk, we're on the street. So we clear up the sidewalk space, more space for planters and cafe tables. When we're walking down the street, I'm rolling down the street in my wheelchair, more space, better pedestrian environment. It actually acts as sort of a pseudo curb extension, because now we don't have a car, blocking visibility. We got something you can see through, so it makes it easier to cross the street. When I did the first one, I put it in North Portland, and there was quite a community conversation between the businesses and the neighborhood. You're doing what, we got to yes, and we put our first one in. 2 weeks later, every business two blocks away signed a petition asking for another one. And now we have about 80 of them. We have about a 2.5-year wait list of businesses requesting them. Bike parking would be really important for driving business, for safety, and for really making people know that I can use my bicycle as a real vehicle in the city for transportation, and it'll be served when I get to my destination.
I just wanted to ask, how do you see the Neighborhood Greenways evolving in 20 years, or 30 years? Where are they going, and what are they going to look like?
Well,
I get a shot.
I got it. Let me go first, because I definitely have an idea. First, we're capturing these corridors, right? These Neighborhood Greenways. That will do a few things. One thing is it'll increase the amount of people that are using a bicycle for transportation and recreation. And transportation trips across the spectrum. And we always focus on commute, but that's probably the wrong one to focus on, right? Getting to the park, getting to the store, this coffee shop, that's the entry level drug. It's not getting to work, all right? Get a lot more people, our market grows, we're able to do more stuff on our busier streets that are hard today, that we're taking out travel lanes, we're taking out, some parking, we're doing bigger projects like that, creating a real system. Now, in terms of the residential stuff, I think we'll move from corridors to areas. So we'll move from a neighborhood greenway concept into a home zone concept. And the home zone concept will be collector street to collector street, collector street to collector street, so what I call a cell, the streets, and treat that cell as a home zone and turn that into a 20-mile-an-hour street. These 20-mile-an-hour zones, all sorts of names all over the place, in your 30K zones, play streets, all these things, it's all the same thing. It's really protecting that residential area, reducing speed, dealing with your crossing treatments. It's neighborhood greenways in an area-wide approach to start to have 20-mile-an-hour zones throughout our city.
The only thing I was going to add to it is I just think they're going to be, my dream is that they were basically laying the foundation for a massive linear park network. People are still going to be able to access their houses, but I think over time people are going to be like, why did this take so long to build this basic infrastructure? Just one note on that is Portland loves the grid. That's where we're really, famous for it. Seattle's famous, the older cities are famous for the grid. If willy-nilly, like we heard earlier, you just put diverters here and there, you destroy a lot of that value of the grid. There's nice things about a grid. If strategically, the streets that we've identified is still a small subset of the street network to get to the 80%+, 90%+ of households within a half mile of one of these family-friendly facilities. So to me, I think what's going to happen is people are going to realize putting maintainers on these kinds of streets, making them trail-like, it doesn't impact the rest of the system very much at all, and creates a massive benefit to the city. So I think there's going to become more and more trail-like. We'll be here in 10 years, and we'll be talking about the standards, 200 cars a day, just to get the moving.
Lizard, Beacon Hill. My wife and I, we did a seven-day fully loaded bicycle trip in Portland, tent-stove sleeping bag, and did about 250 miles. And I think what I noticed the most And I think what the Greenways does beyond that is that in most cities, and Seattle is one of them, somewhere along the line, the streets became this zone that nobody else was supposed to be in other than cars. I grew up in California and the big streets, and you played kickball on the street.
Right.
You did whatever. And so the visual that you get when you're in Portland from all the greenways, and it then translates to all the other streets, is that you realize when you're in Portland that streets have people and carts and whatever. That's just, and I think in a lot of ways it ends up being this benefit that pushes over into the rest. Where in Seattle, we have bike lanes and we have bike whatever, but the streets are still, you know, you shouldn't be there.
Right.
Unless you are in a big metal box.
Right.
And so I think that's another thing. It isn't just the greenway, but it really, so what you do is you arrive in Portland, and even when you're not on a greenway, you realize that how people behave in their vehicles and how they relate to other people is very different. And we talk about an us and them, but you have an us and them when you separate people completely. That's what we've done, and that's what you've done such a good job.
And
that's
what
awesome.
I love about this is that this is, they've done this in 5 years. We can too.
Yeah.
You know, it's 5 till 9. I think we've got time for one more question. You've been so patient, and then what I'd like to do is pass it back to Eli. I want to promise that this is over at 9 o'clock. If people want to stay and talk, that's great, but I think we should at least, honor our commitment from 7 to 9. So go ahead, your last question.
I'm Andres from Canada. I just have a quick question. Are these slides wonderful? Are they online anywhere?
I'm sorry?
Are they available online anywhere?
Your slideshow.
Sure. Yeah, we can give them to Eli. Actually, I think I've already given them to Eli.
Great. Very good. Well, let's say thanks very much. Very